I'll usually hold on to it till he points them out.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to our first press conference for today. Real quick, just the satellite coordinates before we get started. The format is 1080i. The data rate is 11.914. Symbol is 7.2. The FEC is 5 over 6. The MPEG is 4.420. The modulation is DVB-S2QPSK. Audio channels mono 1 and 2, and pilots off. Just ask that you silence your cell phones. There's no flash photography or video recording allowed. And members of the media, when asking questions, we just ask that you raise your hand and wait for the handlers to bring the mic around before asking a question, and just identify yourself by name and affiliation before asking your question. And we ask that you direct your question to a specific student athlete. We are now being joined by three student athletes from Mount St. Mary's: Junior Robinson, Chris Ray, and Elijah Long. And also the SID for Mount St. Mary's is Mark Vandergrift. Mark was around here somewhere. I think he left the room, but. There's Mark. Hey, guys. Good, how are you?
Good.
All right, we'll open the floor for questions for our student athletes. We got a question here on the right. Yeah, right here. Back right.
Daryl Bruce, Mount St. Mary's University. Gentlemen, how does it feel to be in your first NCAA tournament, and starting out here in Dayton, Ohio.
Chris, can you answer that first, and we'll just get on the line that way.
I mean, for me, visually, it's a blessing to be here, you know, and we're going to take full advantage of it.
A surreal moment. I mean, words can't explain, and, you know, I always dreamt to be here, and thankfully I'm here.
It's an honor. I'm just thankful to be here. It's a dream come true.
You're in the right.
Lily O2, Mount St. Mary's. This is a question for Elijah Long. Just a quick question about you and your brother both being in the NCAA tournament, and what does that mean to you and your family?
This goes back, way back when we used to play in the backyard. I mean, this probably means way more to my mom and dad than it means to us, because we've been playing basketball our whole lives. And I feel like we don't really look at it like that, you know, but, you know, seeing that he's in the NCAA March Madness and I'm in NCAA March Madness actually is, like I said, surreal. So I think when we get older, we're going to look back and, like, say that was a crazy experience. But as of right now, going through it, I don't think we're looking at it as it should be looked at right now. But, yeah, it's a good experience, I guess.
Back right, Mike.
Guys, it's the start of a second season, so to speak. But how do you turn the page from a regular season and a conference season to a conference tournament to now in the NCAA once you get on the court?
Chris.
I just think we try to keep it the same way we have during the whole year. I mean, we just try to keep it one game at a time. So, I mean, that way you can't distract yourself from other things going on. Because, I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on with this. And you can say it's the start of a new season, but we just have to keep the same mentality, just one game at a time.
Elijah?
I would say, like, piggyback off of what Chris Ray said, I think if we just lock in on ourselves a little bit more than we did in the season, because, you know, these teams that obviously are here are meant to be here. They're really good teams. So I feel like there's just the littlest things that we can lock in a little bit more into will help us be successful in this tournament.
Junior?
Like they said, we just got to stay more, be more focused and just come out and be ready to play, honestly.
Here on the right.
Junior, Connor O'Neill from the Burlington Times News. I don't know if you've heard of me.
Hey, Connor.
Since last Tuesday, how have things been around campus, and what's been the mood around there?
Well, nobody's really been on campus, so we've just been to ourselves, like, celebrating within each other and just being like brothers.
Any further questions for our student athletes? All right. Junior, Chris, and Elijah, thank you, and good luck tomorrow night. Next scheduled start for press conference is 4:40. We'll be joined by the head coach of Mount St. Mary's, Jamie and Christian. We good? All right, we're now being joined by the head coach of Mount St. Mary's, Jamie and Christian.
Hey, Jamie. John.
Nice to meet you, John.
Nice to meet you.
How you doing?
Jamie, if you like, you can make an opening statement, and then we'll open the floor for questions.
Well, first of all, just can't say how enthusiastic, how happy you are to be here in Dayton. Just one of the best venues for college basketball. The way they celebrate our game each year is really special. And so we're excited to have an opportunity to be back here in Dayton with a chance to start off another great March Madness session. And we're really excited about playing New Orleans. They're a great team. They've had a great year. We've also had a great year. And so we're excited about the opportunity to jump it up here tomorrow night.
Questions for Coach.
You guys have played on.
Hold on just a sec. Get away from the mic.
You guys have played on these stages before this season. How much value does that do you assign to that going into this game?
Well, you know, I think experience is really valuable, and I really feel like when you're able to go through something before and just be able to have a foundation for it, I think it just makes your team stronger. You know, we've also obviously played a very national schedule. We've been on TV several times this year, and you know, our juniors and senior class have been on TV a lot of times. So I don't think the stage will bother them as much as maybe it did for us two or three years ago. But I do think that just understanding the schedule, the time demands when you get here from your media obligations to your practice time to the things you need to do, I do think that our experience here will help us.
Front right again.
Since so much of your team wasn't here in 2014, are you treating this like a new experience?
Well, it's a new, you know, every experience we're going to have with this year's team is going to be a unique experience for each one of these guys. And so because of that, we try to treat it as a unique experience for them. But as coaches who've been here before, we try to set the schedule in a way that allows them time to enjoy their experience, but also understand, you know, what we've got to do with the different time demands. So, you know, like, for example, today we, you know, wanted to get out here a little bit later than we did before, maybe get our guys a little bit more rest between last night's selection show and the time we got here today, and then just making sure that we spend more time in the ballroom walking through stuff than trying to get extra practice in, because that can be a little bit hectic for the guys, and you want them being fresh and confident and aggressive, and sometimes you can overdo it with them being on the floor as much.
Turn left.
What makes Junior Robinson such a special player? I mean, he doesn't have a lot of size, obviously, but seems like he's had a really great year for you guys.
Yeah, and Junior's an inspiration to all of us, right? I mean, you look at him, he's 5'5", he's 165 pounds. He's worked really hard to get up to 165 pounds, believe it or not, really lifting and working hard at it. But, you know, he's such a special player because he's got an enormous heart. And, you know, usually you say that about someone who isn't as talented of a player that he is. But he's just the type of guy that, you know, every single day he'll be one of the hardest workers and just understands what he needs to do. You know, as he's continued to grow up and mature in our program, he's just developed such a winning character inside of him. And, you know, the last year he's been so locked into winning and doing whatever our team needs him to do to help us win that he's really had a chance to show the world his heart and how much he loves playing this game, not just for himself or to showcase his ability, but to showcase to the world how much he loves his teammates. And I think you see that when he plays with Elijah Long, how much energy they play together, and it's really special. And he was really the leader of that. You know, when Elijah came in, he's a year older than Elijah, he really helped to bring him along well. And, you know, those two guys in the backcourt for us are really special. So when you look at Junior, you see a guy with an enormous heart, a tremendous talent level, and a true compassion and empathy level for his teammates. And when you have a guy that can play like that with that kind of talent, you're going to have a really special season.
Front left.
Yes, Jim Klein, Peter, with the Times-Picayune from New Orleans. What's the biggest challenge you have in facing a team like UNO?
Great question. You know, number one, we haven't seen a team like them this season. And, you know, anytime you get to this time of year and you got the top 68 teams left in the country, you're dealing with elite versus elite, and every team in this tournament is an elite team. And so the things that are going to separate us from New Orleans or us from whoever are going to be really small things. You know, one of the things that New Orleans did an outstanding job of, they're tremendous, you know, inside that lane line. They really are going to play a physical game. They're great at getting to the free throw line. You know, and they really do a great job of playing with a high experience level in areas that they're really good at. They turn you over a good bit because they're really good trying to take the ball from you. You know, so it, you know, they're quite a big challenge for us. You know, we haven't seen a team like that this season. I don't think they've seen a team like us this year either. And so I think this makes for a really intriguing game tomorrow night because both teams are a little bit different than what we've seen. Both teams are different from league play, and both teams have gotten a lot better from the beginning of the year until now. And so the team that's going to be able to lock into little things the best and be able to execute their style of play over the other is going to have the best opportunity to pull out a win here tomorrow.
Any further questions, front right?
Of the teams you've played, who does New Orleans remind you of the most?
Yeah, that's a great question. I was trying to explain that earlier today. I think they're a combination of Long Island and of LIU and a combination of LIU and Robert Morris. You know, you look defensively, Robert Morris is about 90 in the country. I want to say New Orleans is somewhere around 100, 104 or so. So very good defensively, great at taking the ball away from you. They don't block a lot of shots, but that means they play great positional defense and really do a great job of stealing the ball from you, especially on drives. So we've got to do a great job taking care of the basketball and making them play, you know, in the half court. And they're one of the better transition offensive teams, similar to LIU, in terms of, you know, they're well over 1 point per possession in transition. And that's a pretty significant number. That shows that not only do they attack you when they rebound the ball, but when they steal it from you, they score it. So we've got to do a great job of being able to play. You know, those opponents, we played really close games with both those opponents this year. And both those opponents are really, really good teams. So to have a combination of those two teams shows a lot of respect for New Orleans and what they've been able to accomplish this season, being able to be a combination of two very good teams that are on our schedule.
Any further questions for Coach? Yeah, middle right.
It's been a little bit of a wait for you guys since your last game. What's practice been like this week without knowing your opponent?
Well, practice with us is always full of enthusiasm and energy. So that's one thing they always bring. We did give them 2 days off. Thought it was really important. I think in general in life and in the course of this, you want to take that time to enjoy big moments in your life. Every one of those guys in that locker room were looking forward to winning a conference championship and a tournament championship their entire life. So I want them to really have at least 48 hours to kind of take a deep breath and enjoy it. I think they did enjoy it. And then we brought them back on Friday just to kind of settle it in a little bit, kind of refocus ourselves on what it was going to take to prepare for whatever opponent we needed to do, just kind of sharpen our craft, so to speak. I thought our guys had great focus and were ready to do that on Friday. We had another great day on Saturday where we got up and down, you know, played a little bit, and got up and down for about 20 minutes and executed well. And on Saturday we did, and then on Sunday we did the same thing. So practice has been great. Guys have had a great focus. I will say the last time we were coming here, I think we took too many days off, and so we wanted to kind of make that change, make sure we kept our guys in attack mode. I thought the guys did an outstanding job of that. But we got great leadership, Khalid Nwandu and Will Miller and Charles Glover, those seniors we have here that have been here before. You know, they really want an opportunity to play well here, and so they really did a great job leading our group through the last few days.
What does it take to refocus the team over these few days?
Yeah. Well, you know, we've got a great group of guys. These guys are really hungry. And, you know, I would say they expected to have a chance to play in the NCAA tournament. You know, we lost a year ago in our tournament, and the guys got right to work immediately. A week later, these guys were right back in the gym, spending a lot of time in there and trying to get better. So, you know, I think they really expected to be here. They wanted to be here. And so to refocus them, it doesn't take a whole lot because they naturally want to be good. They naturally are competitors. You know, and if you're a competitor, you want to show that what you do best works against the very best. There's no other tournament that really provides that better than the NCAA tournament. You're going to sit here with 68 teams, all with an opportunity to win and play at the highest level. And so your ability to refocus is basically connected to your ability to survive in this tournament. And so our guys, they understand it. They have great focus towards it. They were able to refocus and kind of move on to the next goal pretty quickly.
Any further questions? Jamie, thank you. Good luck tomorrow night.
Thank you all.
Appreciate it. Yep. Our next scheduled start for press conference is 5:05. We'll be joined by the student athletes from New Orleans at 5:05.
Family, it's meaningful. It's a one in a lifetime. Not many people can say, you know, hey, I've been to the NCAA March Madness tournament. So, I mean, I'm here and I'm just living it every day, little by little and day by day. So, I'm just enjoying it. And with St. Mary's, I mean, they have a great team. Like he said, feeding off what he said, you know, they had a great non-conference schedule. And they're a hard-working team, so you know, for us to match up to them, people want to see this matchup, and I think it'll be a great game tomorrow.
Front left on the aisle.
It's been several years, but is there Katrina took out a lot of things there, including nearly your school and your program. Is there still a sense even now when something great like this happens that it's part of putting that behind you, overcoming the shadow of that, that after this many years?
Chris Davies, can you answer that?
No doubt. You know, a couple years ago, UNO had to go Division III. Once they opened back up out of the Sun Belt, and it's huge because going Division III and then coming back up and going back to Division I, even when people think we couldn't, and you know, bringing the program up from there 6 years later, we're five or six years later, and we're here now. It means a lot to the city, and you know. It means a lot to everybody that was involved in Hurricane Katrina. You know, it's some people may have cried. You know, even alumni from our school. You know, I've seen some cry. So I mean, it's really important, but it's also important to us to make them happy. I mean, that's something that anybody would want to see, and it made me so proud and my teammates so proud that those people were happy.
Yeah, I would agree with what Tay-Tay just said. When you have an event such like Katrina having come through New Orleans. Any events such as what we're going through, what the Saints did, winning the Super Bowl, is going to be magnified because it's all a part of the regrowing process. I would even still venture to say that New Orleans is still in a rebuilding process as well as our university. So there's a lot of areas of New Orleans that hasn't come back from Katrina. My father himself, he's from the Ninth Ward, and we live in Houma now, and he went to visit his neighborhood, and it's not even there anymore. So, you know, to go back and see things like that, it just gives us that more fight. You know, during games, you know, we're playing for things bigger than just us. We're playing bigger than just a trophy. We're playing for, you know, the regrowth of our school, our student attendance. We're just trying to get people to rally behind us to give them something to hope for. But, you know, people in New Orleans love sports, so that I figured that'd be a good way to do it.
Arch.
start with you, Chris Davis, and then go. Why did you? You're a senior, right?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Why bother? Why did you come there? If you know the thing 4 years ago looked pretty tough, and did you get like a lot of scholarship offers, or you didn't have a lot of D1 offers, or why come to New Orleans?
Okay. Actually, Coach Sliss, he was assistant coach at Northwestern, and I'm from, 30, 40 minutes away from Northwestern State, so I would go to camps and my team would play up there for certain tournaments, and, Coach Sliss was recruiting me, and he ended up taking a head coaching job at New Orleans, so he offered me my junior year, and that was my only Division I offer. I mean, schools were showing interest, but that was my only Division I offer, and Coach Sliss believed in me from the beginning, from 4 years before I even became a senior. I was a freshman in high school, and, he believed in me, and he believed that we had a future for this program to bring it back to where it was back in the 90s, the 80s and the 90s, and, I believed in him as well, and my family believed in him as well, and that kind of made my decision fairly easy. So,
Nate, my situation was the same as Chris Davis. I really didn't have that many college offers coming out of high school either. I went to a really small high school. I had one other offer from UTC Chattanooga, and the day I was supposed to go and visit the coach and the athletic director got fired. So I'm a person that believes in destiny, and when Coach Chris called maybe the day after, we went and visited the school. I went up there with my family, and I think the thing that they were most impressed by was Coach Sless's attitude toward winning and his values that he instilled himself as a man that he taught to his players. And I think that got them from day one. That got me as well. And the thing about Coach Sless is he's going to work you to the bone, but at the end of the day, you're going to feel good about what you did in the practice arena, what you're doing in the community. We do a lot of community service work. We just recently had a tornado. New Orleans doesn't really get tornadoes like that. So we went and helped people, clean up and everything. And it's not for media attention. We don't do it for that. We do it because, like I said before, we're still trying to help the city rebuild. And when something like that happens, we try to, put a hand in and do whatever we can to get the job done. So.
Basically, what these guys are saying is, if it wasn't for our coaching staff, they gave us a lot of opportunities to come here. It wasn't just, we wanted to come to the school just because it's destiny. And, each and every one of us have our different stories of why we got here. Of course, I'm a JUCO transfer. So, Coach gave us the opportunity to play Division I basketball. A lot of these guys had to take that chance, coming from a Division III to Division II, Division I, that's a lot of jumps. So they put faith in the coaches, and that's personally why I came to this school. I love the family-oriented program that we had. All the coaches showed interest in what I had, and they believed in me. So that helped me make the decision to come to New Orleans.
Tevin?
Me, Tay, and Nate all have similar situations coming out of high school. We didn't really have many scholarships. We had people that showed interest, but Coach Schlesinger, University of New Orleans, was my first offer. They offered me right off the spot after visiting me. So coming from a small town like Goshen, Mississippi, it's a blessing to receive. And the reasons why I came here is because Coach, he had a vision. He believed that we can rebuild the program, and he believed in us. He told us in the recruiting process that, how things were here. And so I felt like if I came here, I can be a part of something great. I can make history. And I just feel like this is what we're doing. And so, and also when I came on my visit, my previous teammates treated me like family. So that really just made me buy in, and it made me commit. So I'm just thankful and give all the glory to God.
Right here, front left.
Yeah, Eric, you came in 2 years after the other three seniors, and y'all kind of grew together after that. How hard was it to break into that? How accepting were they of you? And I'd like for the other players just to talk a little bit about him coming in and how y'all accepted him.
Coming into to the program my junior year, the key word I would say is I had to earn my stripes coming in, just like any other player in this nation would have. I had to come in and be able to produce. I wasn't coming in to sit on the bench at all whatsoever. So, coming in, I knew being undersized post, I was already at a disadvantage. So my work ethic and, you know, really just spoke for itself. I had to come in here and work with these guys and become brothers with them. It was a great experience. You know, as soon as I got there, you know, they all treated me like I'm one of their own. You know, we linked in real quick with each and every one of us. So I would say, you know, it was a great family environment for me coming in. And they made me feel right at home.
Devin?
I'm sorry, could you repeat what you said again?
Okay.
Man, it was pretty fun having Eric come in, man. Last year, you know, things didn't go how we wanted. You know, we still stayed together. You know, I'm actually glad that, you know, God put us together, because He put something special. I don't know, you know, why we crossed paths. You know, God put him in our lives, but I'm just thankful, man. Like, I mean, he's an amazing dude. He's a great player, man. It's just good to have him on our team. And, you know, he's proven himself this year, you know, that he can play with the best. And so I'm just so thankful to have him on my team and in my life, man. And I'm just, you know, I just wish him the best of luck, man. It's just, I don't know. It's unbelievable. I can't really explain it. I'm sorry.
Nate, what'd you think of Eric?
I personally don't like Eric. I'm just playing. Nah, me and Eric, we spent a lot of time with each other, especially last year. We went on a trip with each other, got to know each other a lot, and it was his first year coming out. I felt like we really vibed. And then I know Christavius and Tevin can say the same thing. He just gelled in right with our brotherhood, and that's what our team mostly is a brotherhood. And, you know, him being new had nothing to do with, you know, him gelling with the team. It wasn't going to be an issue, because anytime we have a new player come in, we're gonna make sure he feels right at home. We're gonna show him the ropes. We're gonna tell him what not to do, what to do, to make his make his transition from one school to next school as smooth as possible. Because, you know, you go from different coaches, philosophies are very different, game styles are very different, and so, you know, it was important that we communicated to him, you know, what you need to do to be successful. And, you know, he listened to the coaches, and you know, he's become a great player because of it. You know, I'm also glad he's here. He's made a great impact on the Southland, and I'm, you know, a lot of people have seen what he's doing at his size. And, you know, we call him Charles, like Charles Barkley's. When he first got here, he was a rebounding machine. He was trying to figure out how he was doing it, but he just fit in with our brand. He was a hard-working player at his size, and, you know, it was like, okay, yeah, this guy's going to fit right in with our program, so.
Christavius?
Man, Eric just works. I mean, coming in, you could tell that he had the dedication and that same attitude we had, and we didn't even know him. So, I mean, that tells a lot about him and his personality, his attitude. He's always positive, never negative. And, I mean, he picks everybody up. I mean, he works hard. Like, you can tell just watching him play, you can tell how hard he crashes the glass and how much he cares about the next person beside him. Not only scoring the ball, but passing the ball, rebounding, and playing defense for the next person. And it's an amazing feeling. And as far as coming in, I think he gelled in well. As far as our attitudes was the same. Like, everybody had the same thought process. You know, everybody wanted to win, and that's vital to any program. So, I mean, I compliment Eric for that, and I appreciate him for it.
Got time for a few more. Any further? Arch? Yep.
I saw pictures of your coach in that red crawfish suit or something. Like, did you ever see that? Or does that? I just can't. He seems like he'll do anything to help involve in the community or promote. Like, I can't imagine Calipari or Rick Pitino in a.
That's what makes that man great. I would have to say, that's what makes all of us blue collar. He's our role model when it comes to leading an example for the community. We're big on that, you know. Whether it's someone way in the hood, way in the country, no matter where we're at, we've been everywhere, honestly. We've been way out in the country, places you never heard of in Louisiana. Personally, I haven't until I got there. And we were out there helping just of floods, tornadoes, no matter what the situation was. So I'm actually proud to be a privateer, because I done helped so many families out that had so many issues with homes being tore down, water filling up 6 feet up into their houses, and helping them, you know, giving them that hope and that joy and that happiness back into their lives. So if it wasn't for Coach Sless, you know, being able to reach out to the community and talk and volunteer us just to get us there, you know, I wouldn't be able to experience this.
Good time for a couple more. Any further questions for our student athletes? All right, gentlemen, thank you. Good luck tonight, or tomorrow night, excuse me.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
We're now joined by the head coach of the New Orleans Privateers, Mark Schlesinger. Mark, if you would like, you can start with an opening statement, and then we'll open the floor for questions.
Well, it's an unbelievable honor to be in Dayton. In 2001, I was lucky enough to be an assistant coach at Northwestern State and playing the first ever play-in game. Or then it was a play-in game. It wasn't even called an opening round game. But it was one of the most special experiences that I've ever had in coaching. And that was because of the city of Dayton, the approach that the University of Dayton took towards this event and made it something that our student athletes, I got 3-4 texts in the last 24 hours from guys that were on that team about how awesome and how great the experience was. So in preparing our team for this trip and coming, that was a big piece of it is me telling them how great of an experience they were gonna have in the city in this storied arena, and it means a lot to me to be back here with a really phenomenal group of student athletes that I think are very tough-minded, exciting team to watch play.
Questions for Coach here on the aisle.
There are 68 teams who appreciate this, but given what you've come from, this program has come from, can anyone possibly appreciate this moment more than you can?
I it would be hard for me to believe that anybody could. You know, when I arrived in that first year, and we were kind of nomadic, I guess, to a certain extent, because we didn't have a conference home or affiliation. We were in flux in classification for what division we were going to be. I had 3 student athletes committed that were staying in the program and there on my press conference. Didn't have an assistant, didn't have a lot of other things, but I knew I was in a great city. I knew I was at a great university with incredible people that were dynamic and had great bones and structure, I guess, to build a program around. And we had an incredible history of what basketball was as a mid-major power in the 80s and 90s. But for us to come full circle and for this moment to be real, I wish I could put it into words in the right way that could sound eloquent, but I don't think it's possible. Because I know the sacrifices that our kids have made, the sacrifices my staff has made to get us to this point, and the people that have been behind us. And once you live in New Orleans, it's different. You know, your life is different. Your perspective is different. When you were there and you see, I mean, on my block alone, I got 5 empty lots still on my block. So things still are never going to be what they were in some ways. But there's a lot of people that this means a lot to that has nothing to do with basketball, but it means a lot to them that we're back and we're a champion, and the city feels like it's a champion, and the people of the city feel like they're champions again.
Back right.
Coach, it's been, I guess, exactly about 24 hours since you found out who you were going to play.
Yes, sir.
And I'm sure you've been going over tape, scouting, and all of that stuff. What do you know about Mount St. Mary's? What do you see as some of your challenges, et cetera, et cetera?
Well, ironically, I watched a championship game of the Northeast Conference. I'd watched them another time earlier, a few weeks ago. I had a feeling that if we were in this position, that would be one of the teams we played. I think they got a great team. I think they're dynamic. I think they can play a style that is probably as polar opposite as there is as to ours. I think if the committee was making matchmaker scenarios, if it was a prize fight and they were putting styles against each other, I don't know if they do that in the opening round games, you could chuckle about it. But I mean, they did a great job if they were matching up styles, because we're as different as it can be, and they're very, very good at what they do, and they can create tempo, they can score it a lot of different ways, and they got some guys that in my day you would say they got some motor scooters, they can move, man, and they can get up and move, and we're gonna have to defend at a high level. To keep them from scoring, and then we're not going to have to not turn it over against them.
Yep, front right or left.
Some teams maybe might not want the first four, but one of the upsides of it is that it puts the 16 seed in position, excellent position, to have a chance to win a game. Can you talk about that aspect of it?
Yeah, I mean, I want to be in this tournament. I mean, and our guys want to be in this tournament. We didn't care what seed we were. And for us – I love the opportunity again. I don't mean to come back to it again, but I love the opportunity for me selfishly, for my student athletes to experience this, because this is not what it's like at the other places. You know, the second time I was in the tournament, it was not as special as how people treated you in the environment as this is. And so to be able to come to play a like level team, that is also a conference champion and a tournament champion on a neutral court, on national TV, and be the first game of this entire tournament, the world's greatest tournament, the world's greatest sporting event. No disrespect, World Cup, but this is the world's greatest sporting event. Woo! It's pretty cool. It's pretty awesome. And we couldn't be happier to be here and be a part of it.
Yeah, front left again.
Yeah, Mark, bringing in Eric, when you had three seniors that had been there 2 years already, was there any worry about how we would mix chemistry-wise, or was he the final piece of the puzzle that brought you here?
Yeah, you know, I think right away we knew that he was special. When he got a chance in the recruiting process to get to know his family, he was very grounded. He comes from a great basketball family. I knew right away that he was a team player, would sacrifice and do the things he needs to do. And I think the guys that we had around him knew that and bought into it. So they've been peanut butter and jelly ever since he got here, and it's been fun to watch them all grow together.
Yeah, front right.
Eric probably didn't have one of his best games in the conference championship game, but then you look at the stats and he still finished with a double-double. He made some huge plays. Is that kind of what typifies him, that he doesn't, if it's not flowing for him, he doesn't force it and he still finds a way to be a huge factor?
Yeah, he wants to win. He wants to win more than he wants to score. And I think that's why he was the player of the year in our league. And the other night was a great example where, I mean, they put a lot of focus on him and were double-teaming and bluff double-teaming him. And he didn't force stuff. He made an extra pass and moved the ball around to get guys better shots. And then he got in and rebounded and defended at a high, high level. And that's what you'll see tomorrow night as well. He's going to want to win more than he's going to want to score. He's not hung up on that. And he made a clear decision when he was in the scoring race with Rashawn Thomas for our league scoring title. He just said, Coach, I'm not hung up on that. I want to win this league more than I want to win the scoring title. And it all worked out for him. Yes, sir.
Arch.
Yeah, Coach. What kept you going when, you know, there's been three other coaches there since Katrina, and they all left for assistant jobs someplace, mm-hmm. and you just kept staying. What did you see, or what did you know, or
Well, there's some pieces of it. If, you know, you have to love the community. I met my wife there. My daughter is named Nola Ann. We're as attached and grounded as we could be in that community. And once you're there and if you love it, then it's awful hard to pry you out of it. And then when you have administrators and a president that believes in you and gives you time and tells you to do it the right way and tells you not to take shortcuts on character and tells you not to shortcut on making a good, great decision over a good decision in recruiting, I don't know why I would leave. Everybody dreams of having some autonomy in how you're going to run your shop, and or for me, my coaching ministry. And those people were, I was blessed that those people gave me that chance. And I was in it for the long haul. I never wanted to be the guy that walked out just because it wasn't comfortable. There's a lot of people in our community and in our city, and two of them sitting here in the front row that have lived very uncomfortably for a lot of years, but they believe in the bigger picture of our city and what we're doing. And I think sometimes when you're uncomfortable a little bit, you grow and you get a lot better. And I think that going through this process has made me a lot better coach and a lot better man and a lot better mentor for these guys, for sure. And so I wasn't going to cut and run.
Anything further for Coach Schlesinger? Yep, right here.
Yes, Mark, have you heard from some of the other Northwestern State Mafia coaches that have been through the tournament and your background guys?
Yeah, it's been great to hear from Coach McConathy and so many of the other people that were here in this experience with me in Dayton. But then I've heard from a lot of the UNO people. That guys that were, you know, from going back to Tick Price to Tim Floyd and Wayne Cooper and Terry Gill and all those people that were the pillars of our program. And just to hear their voice and hear the spring in their voice again about what's happened, it's special. It's special. But this has been an unbelievable run, and I wish that there was more time. Like you, I'm happy that we're here, but you wish you had one or two more days to process it and to really get more people involved and to experience it and be part of the ride with you. But it's a quick turnaround from pulling in on campus yesterday at 3 o'clock and getting changed and figuring out we're coming here at 4:30 and then trying to get on a plane and having the guys in the locker room at 9:15 in the morning. I still got a dirty suit. I got to figure out how to get a suit cleaned between now and tomorrow night. So at Dayton, I'm going to need some help.
Anything further for Coach? All right, Mark, thank you.
Thank you. Good luck tomorrow night. Appreciate it. Thank you all. My daughter is three and a half, and my son will be five. N-O-L-A, and then A-N. Yes, sir.
A-N-N or A-N-N?
A-N-N. Thank you. She got her own website. It's on the front of the computer. That's, I keep waiting for that one.
Yeah, we're going to have to hire her.
Yeah, we're going to have to.
Our next scheduled start for a press conference is 5:50. We'll be joined by student athletes from Kansas State at 5:50.